Good morning. Welcome to St. Peter and Zion Church in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, where we're under the leadership of Bishop Seth Olarte and our presiding elder, Reverend Dr. Jeffrey L. Cannon. Called to worship. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. We ought to rejoice and be glad in it. I'm so excited to be here once again, because God has blessed us, he has kept us, he has watched over us all week long, all year long, and for that we come into this house to lift him up in spirit and in truth. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, thank you once again for allowing us, Lord, to worship you. Father, we come right now in Jesus' name, thanking you for allowing us to lie down last night and to wake up this morning in our right mind with our blood running warm through our veins, Father. For that, we're truly grateful. But we're grateful for your son, Jesus, who have died on the cross for each and one of us, that we might have a right to the tree of life. Now, Father, we ask that you would prepare us all, Lord, for this worship service. We ask that if there's anything standing in our way, remove it right now in Jesus' name, that we may lift you up higher and higher, in spirit and in truth. Then, Father, we ask if we've done anything that you wasn't pleased with since we've last met, Father. We ask that you forgive us in Jesus' name. Cast him in the sea, forgive from us, remember him no more in this life or in the judgment. We praise you right now, Lord, and we give you all the thanks, all the glory. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen, amen, amen. Good morning again. This morning, before we get started into our worship service, we wanted to have a Black History Moment. And our Black History Moment, we will talk about Jane E. Elliott. Jane E. Elliott was the first person to establish a cafeteria system at a Black college. And reportedly, the first to do so in the Deep South. Beyond her historic contribution, Mrs. Elliott is the great aunt of Tom Joyner. He's retired from the radio station, but that's his great aunt, and her memories live on at Tennessee State University. In 1924, Elliott established a program at the former Tennessee A&I College after joining the staff as a cafeteria consultant 2 years prior. She stressed the importance of proper nutrition for her students and garnered national attention for implementing the system. Other schools began seeking out Elliott's food service expertise for their own cafeteria programs, adding to a legacy solely centered on a proper food service and management. Beyond the cafeteria, Elliott served as a mentor for students and also helped potential students gain access to the college. Education was just as important as food service to Elliott. So Elliott raised Tom's aunt at the college, providing a strong foundation for her loved ones early on that still stands firm today. Tennessee State University dedicated the Jane E. Elliott Building to her memory in 1996. Brothers and sisters, Jane E. Elliott for our Black History Moment. That will end our Black History Moment. Now I want to introduce our guest speaker today. He's no stranger to none of us that are here at St. Peter in Zion. Those of you visiting, he's a preacher, associate preacher, ordained elder, amen, has been preaching for some time. I met him maybe 5 or 6 years ago. Here, I think I met him at Cracker Barrel in Bessemer. We were having dinner, and we showed up to eat, and they were there ready to eat. So I don't know if you remember that, but I remember the first time I met. It was at Cracker Barrel. But I know he preached at Mount Hermon, as well as other churches. He's married to Mrs. Renita Abernathy. Amen. It's his beautiful wife that walks side by side with him. So after this song, we will hear from Reverend Fredrick Abernathy to deliver the morning message. Amen.
See what God loves you that moment.
Oh, Let the church say amen. Amen. Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
Let the church say amen one more time. I'm so thankful and honored to, amen, stand before you. I just, as I endeavor to do that this morning, I just can't help but remembering the psalmist, the Psalms 100. It says something like, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Come before the Lord, oh hallelujah, with singing. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God? It is he that has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Hallelujah. Oh, be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generations. Hallelujah. I'm just so thankful this morning, and I just like to begin by, amen, just thanking the Lord for his goodness, his mercy, his grace, his love toward us. And by doing that, I would like to keep, I have people that I have to keep in my heart for enabling me to be in the position, in this, the place where I am. And that's our, of course, our presiding prelate of the Alabama, Florida district area. And that's the Right Reverend Seth Larte, the missionary supervisor, Miss Jacqueline Larte. And then there's our presiding elder of the Tuscaloosa district, it's Dr. Cameron and his wife, Mrs. Evira Cameron. And of course, the pastor of this church, Reverend Patrick Freeman, and his wife, Sister Chandra Freeman.
Amen.
I'm just so honored to, amen, to greet you all. I do have to say that, amen, this great St. Peter family, I know that you're there. I can feel you're there. I can sense your presence. I just want to just hold my hand up and just tell you thank you for all the prayers and all of the times that you've been endeavoring to, desiring to have me come here. And of course, you know, duty calls. So you have to go where you're listed to go, but my St. Peter family, all of you guys, and especially my lovely wife, Renita, I just want to lift her up, tell her that, amen, and coincidentally, it's Valentine's Day, so I think it'd be safe to say I love all of you guys in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless you in the name above every name, Jesus Christ. It's good to be here, amen. It's good to be able to, amen, to stand before me, and I just thank God for each and every one of you. Amen. But before I do anything, let me just pray with you. Just pray with me, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you again for another time. And I just pray even now that your word would have free course amongst us. And Father, I just give you all the thanks, the praise. Come, Holy Spirit, sweet heavenly dove, with all thy cleansing power. Kindle a flame of sacred love in these cold hearts of ours, Father. I just thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. God bless you this morning. It's always an honor to stand before God's people. It's always an honor to, amen, to be in all of our presence because, and it just so happened to be Valentine's Day. So all of us at one time or another have been guilty of looking for love in all the wrong places. Oh, Lord. But I can say that with I think as we go along, we know that, amen, and that's exactly what it was, looking for love in all the wrong places. And then there are some people that said that love is blind. I like that, but I don't think that that's true love. The word love is a lot more meaningful to all of us than just that. We've even established a program where we can go out on a blind date, having never seen them. And then we also attribute ourselves to another cliche, love at first sight. All of these different things that we say about love doesn't even give a minute place of what love really means to each one of us in our life. But so it has been sought out. It have been, there are many people that say love is a many splendid thing. That's love. What has love got to do with it? And even people have tried different things to find love. But one of the most strangest things that we could ever look up and get love from is if all we have to do is try it, is in the Word of God. And that's what I want to talk to you all about today, the love of God. In the Bible, if you would, please turn with me to John chapter 15, verses 12 through 17. John 15, verses 12 through 17. I just want to just look at this, amen, this verse of scripture. It says here, amen, in this 12th verse, in the 15th chapter of the book of St. John, it says that, the writer says that this is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. And he goes on to say, 13, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I've heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. These things I command you, that you love one another. Amen. The book of John entails that we as Christian believers ought to love one another. And it appears to me that what Jesus did when he said, amen, that we ought to love one another, it seems that he made a resemblance, a very resemblance of our obedience to that command. He said, I have commanded you that you love one another. But it seemed like it don't click, it don't connect us to each other until you follow up on the obedience of it. And that's why I just want to stop and just tell you right now, in the name of Jesus, I love you all in the Lord. So I mean, don't, I ain't holding no punches back. I love you all. I love you all in radio land. I love you. I love you. And I appreciate you more than anything. And most of all, I thank the Lord for you. And this is what the apostle was talking about. He's talking about a love that reaches out. Somebody has said at one point or another that love is a connection. But the only way you can, amen, feel that connection is that you got to have that love. That love that starts deep down inside. Now this word love, oh hallelujah, it cannot be associated down to just one little word to mean what we think it ought to mean. It has a trifold meaning. That's a different meaning. That's a meaning that in the Bible, they say that charity is love. And that was the word that they associated love with, because they couldn't find another or act of love that would really bring this word into focus. It has such a profound meaning that it, once one think about it, it really do have that profound meaning. A love is something that it reaches out. It loves you in spite of it. It loves and it keeps on loving. It don't stop. Like tomorrow, somebody might say, I love you today, but then tomorrow, I don't like what you did today. But the kind of love that he's talking about, it still reaches out to one another. It still reaches out. And sometimes you have to find it in your heart to say, well, it's not so much as me loving the person or not loving the person, but it's what that person does that separates. But love, it stands for whatever you're doing that is right. Love, it stands for the righteous part of the act of doing love. In the Bible, we come to understand that love comes from charity. Now, this word charity, It has a meaning too. It has a trifold meaning. The first love, the first trifold meaning, the first word that I would like to associate with love is called filial. A lot of people have known it to be Philadelphia because it's the art of the love that we call a brotherly love. And that's when we learn how to live with each other, we follow up on the command that God says that we ought to love one another. And that's sort of that brotherly love that I'm talking about. Now, it's said that no other love can a man have than this. We oftentimes associate it with it in the Bible in 1 John 4:20. If a man say, I love God and hated his brother, he is a liar. For how can he love it not his brother whom he has seen? How can he love God whom he has not seen? So this commandment, the apostles say in 1 John 4:20, this commandment have we received from him, that he who loveth God, he loveth his brother also. So it's a connection. It's a way that, oh Lord have mercy, it's a way that we ought to be with each other. And we can believe it or not, you may not believe this, but you can actually feel love. I mean, a lot of people don't want to say that it's got fit. If somebody come in here and love you and love you and love you, and then all of a sudden they're not there to love you anymore, I bet you miss their presence. I guarantee you miss their presence. So love is a way that it's an overwhelming feeling that you get when you know somebody loves you and gonna stand for you no matter what. A certain situation that came up in the times of Saul, where two women were living in the same house. And they both had a baby, a little small baby, except that one, in the course of the night, in the middle of the night, one of the ladies rolled over, overlaying herself on the baby and killed the baby. And took that dead baby and switched it and put it in the place where the other baby was. And then they took the matter, they got up the next morning, they were arguing with each other. That's my baby. No, it's my baby. No, it's not your baby, it's my baby. So they took the matter, they took the dispute to King Solomon. You know King Solomon, he was a very wise king. And King Solomon took the matter and he sat there and he listened at them. They're going back and forth, disputing about whose child it was. Mm-hmm. And so what King Solomon did is to bring me a sword. Yep. So when he got the sword, the real mother looked at that child and she understood that it was a matter of dispute that was between two women. But she loved that child because she knew it was her child. And she loved it so much that she said, wait, King Solomon, wait, please. Just give the baby to him. And the other lady said, no, go ahead and slay it. But King Solomon looked at the other lady and then he looked at the one that just pleaded for the child's life. It ain't no sense in us fighting and arguing, and he's getting ready to split the baby in half and give you half and give me half, and I don't want a dead baby. And as a matter of fact, if you kill this baby, we'll have two dead babies. So King Solomon used his wisdom, and he told him, he said, take the baby and give it to this lady. And that proved that King Solomon had a wisdom that was beyond any other. Now, this kind of love was called a family type of love. They were both in the same house. This is what's called the word love is a derivative called storge. That's the Greek form of the word. It means a family type of love. This is where it becomes effective. In all of our lives, here we are in a world that's right here. And here most of us still fighting against each other. Lord have mercy, it behooves me to say that I don't need to say nothing about Capitol Hill right now. So please help y'all bear with me as I continue on. Amen. Just mentioning, oh glory be to God, about how a lot of us think we can almost do anything and get away with everything. But I just want you to know that love has such a profound meaning to it that it means more than what we oftentimes allude to it meaning. Notice, if you will, that glory be to God, that the writer in the book of John, he mentioned a word before love. He said, greater love hath no man than this, that a man would lay down, Lord have mercy, his life for his friend. In defining the word love, I mentioned to you very briefly, of course, I mentioned to you the art of brotherly love, contacted with obedience, and then I mentioned the word storage, which is a family kind of love. Now we get into the good part, the love that each of you all already know that I'm headed toward the key word, which is agape. Lord have mercy, it's a divine type of love. And a lot of us can overwhelmingly understand how is it that a man can lay down his life for us and we still not figure how he, but it's all because he cared for us. That's why we can cast all our cares upon him, because he cared for us. But the Bible said that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And what that means when he say greater love hath no man than this is that God has a divine type of love where it reaches out to us. And the only way we can see God is we have to have the love that reaches out to each other. Because from what the minister, what the apostle said is that if we first say that I love God, we must love our brothers also. And with obedience, the only way we can feel that love is see the love that God has for all of us. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, what manner of love he has bestowed upon us who are the children of God when he blessed us. Oh, what manner of love did he love us when he came down from glory? Anybody know what I'm talking about? I say he came down from glory when he come into this earth. He came down from glory because he loved us. Oh, hallelujah. The Bible said that we love him, and he first loved us. Oh, glory to his name this morning. I just want to just stop and just tell you just for a minute that oh, hallelujah. This is when love really came down. Amen. The Bible says that God in all his awesomeness, it was God before the mountains were brought forth. It was God before even the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, it was God that did this. Don't you know him? Oh, hallelujah. Who is it that haven't heard of how great our God is? Well, it's he who sent upon the circle of the earth and looking down at the inhabitants as grasshoppers, right? Who stretches out in heaven as a curtain, as a tent for men to dwell in. It's God in all his mercy, how he loved us. He loved us so much that he decided to give us, amen, his son Jesus.
Yeah.
As a sacrifice for the sins of the world. And one thing that he does for us, he washes us and makes us whole. Yeah, I stand here right here. I'm free today because I trusted in him. I believed in him. I'm hanging on to his promises. I'm clinging on to his word. It's God that does this. Oh, glory to his name. I heard Jesus say, he said, I love my life. He said, but I take it and I lay it down. He said, I lay it down that I might pick it up again. And I just want to just stop by here today to just let you know that it was God that loved us first before we could ever think about loving him in return. No wonder the apostle said, I therefore beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body as living sacrifice. Give something back to him this morning. Give something back to him. And he goes on to say that, amen, that it was God that cleansed, woke us up this morning.
Yeah.
And I just want to stop right there. And I just want to say, yes, he woke us up. But I'm oftentimes reminded, but when somebody asked Jesus, when Jesus was on the face of this earth, the master, where you going? And Jesus turned around and said, birds have nests,
yeah,
foxes have holes, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. But Jesus didn't have a place to lay his head, and he created the whole universe. Lord, I'm going to say, that's just something for you to think about. But God loved us so much that he allowed Jesus to come into this world and become a sacrifice for each and every one of us. That Jesus loved us so much, even while we were yet sinners,
yeah,
Christ died for us. He looked beyond everything that we did. He looked beyond it, and he said, I'm going to bless them. I'm going to love them anyway. He said, it's my point of my case. He loved us. He kept for us. And I just want to stop to tell you this morning, oh, hallelujah, that this is how merciful he is toward us. Oh, hallelujah. I'm reminded of a man of God that stood before this desk, this sacred desk, and he said, this I recall and bring to my mind, that it's of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassion fail not. I want you to know, my sisters and my brothers, this morning, that God is above all, and if his thoughts are higher than our thoughts and his ways are higher than our ways. He's the kind of God, I heard somebody say, he sit high, but he look low. He's the kind of God that no matter how far you go, amen, you can't go far enough. He can kick down and bring you back in. No matter how low you go, if you go down to the floor, God can, amen, pick you up. No matter how high you go, I heard the writer tell me, amen, in the book of Psalms, if I take the wings of a dove and I go to the uttermost parts of the earth, God is still there. If I make my bed in hell, God is still there. I don't want to say this morning that I don't want to make my bed in hell, but I do want to be with where God is. And therefore, with saying that, I accept the sacrifice. And this is all wrapped up in one thing. I heard the writer say this, that, amen, if you believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, that you ought to confess it with your mouth that God has raised him, and with the heart you ought to believe unto righteousness. It said that because we don't have to say who will bring him back down to the deep, because, amen, he's already did what he did, and he don't have to do it no more. Good God Almighty. So I just want to stop by here today to say that when Jesus, amen, came down through 42 generations, when he was laying on the cross, when he stood before mankind, when he died before the world, he said, it is finished. I looked and I saw where he who called himself the water of life, when he was thirsty. I looked and I saw that he who called himself the bread of life, good God Almighty, he said, it's finished. Good God Almighty. That's why it reminds me of when the God was in a man back down in Egypt a long time ago. He said, your fathers ate manna in the desert, and they are dead. But this bread that you eat, it'll make you live forever. If you, amen, take the word of God, if you take the bread of life, if you take Jesus, oh, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. If you take Jesus as your bread of life, you can eat of this bread and live forever. I got one more thing to go, and I'm going to my seat. I just want to tell you, I just got one more thing to say, and I'm going to my seat. I'm so glad, thank you, Jesus, that when Jesus died,
yeah,
he didn't stay dead. Hallelujah.
Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Amen.
The
Bible say that happened after the third day, there was an earthquake. Good God Almighty, that the angels came down and sat on the stone. That, amen, where in the tomb where he was. And they came, and amen, then the apostles came back the next day. They want to come so they can decorate, so they can spice the body up. But when they came, they asked the question, how seek ye the living? How seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here, for he is risen. And that's why I say this morning that no matter how you look at it, he's risen. And he's risen because he loved us. He laid down his life and he took it back again just for you. Just for you, so you can say to each other, I love you. He did it just for you, so that you can say that I have loved you because I'm your brother, and regardless of how you look at it, I'm still going to love you no matter what you say. No matter what you do toward me, I still love you. God bless you this morning. Amen. I just wanted to take a little time out to just say thank you, my sisters and brothers. God bless you.
Your grace and mercy brought me through. I'm living this moment because of you. I want to and praise you too. Your grace and mercy brought me through. For that I should die.
Disciples, if we have love for one another. So I'm going to open the door for you to those that are still having trouble, those who are struggling with love, those who have a problem loving their brothers and your sisters, to lay those things down today and let God change your heart and change your mind that you will show love for one another. So if you're standing at guilty distance away from God, and not only that you don't love your brothers and sisters, but you don't love God. So allow him to work in your life today and allow him to love you just as much as you love one another. Amen. So if you find it in your heart today and you're struggling, don't be ashamed to call one of us at 205-759-2753. We can pray with you. We could talk with you. We can encourage you to show more and more love. And not only this day, but this day and going forward. Amen. And there may be someone that might be just need to connect with God, need to be baptized. You can also call 205-759-2753. Let me pray with you. We can set up a time to meet. We could do something. We want to help you. The Lord told us to go into the world and to make disciples, to go out and preach and baptize to those that don't know me. Teach them about my word. Teach them about me and what you're all about. So that's what we do here at St. Peter's. We want to make disciples, amen. But we may have someone that is already in the discipleship, already a member of St. Peter, that might be struggling right now, that may have decided to take a break, that may have just fallen off the wagon just for a little while. God will allow you to come back. Amen. The good part about it, if we're headed in the wrong direction, he'll allow us to make a U-turn, to turn back to him. If you're struggling in that area, you can also call us at 205-759-2753. Amen. There may be someone out there that's just looking for a church home, that walking the straight and narrow, that's have a relationship with God, that's praying, but they just don't have a house to go to, don't have any where to worship. You can worship with us. By Facebook, by Zoom. But if you haven't need to place membership, you can call us as well, 205-759-2753. If I don't answer, you can leave a message. I will call you back. Amen. Before I get into the further announcements, I do want to say that we'll have a meeting on Wednesday night after Ash service with our church opening committee. That's what I call them. Those of you that know who you are, right after the Ash service, we will talk about being back in worship on March the 7th with two services, social distance, and there'll be more instructions coming forth after we meet. Thank you. You may join us in our live morning worship service each Sunday morning via Facebook or the St. Peter AME Zion Church website, media page at 11 a.m. Services will also be available via St. Peter YouTube page, radio broadcast on 104.3 FM. Then join us at 5 p.m. each Sunday evening for our weekly Zoom Sunday School lesson and Children's Church by dialing 312-626-6799. Then enter meeting ID 829-8090-6941. Then join us at 6 p.m. this Wednesday for our Tuscaloosa Lesson District Ash Wednesday service via Zoom. Then join us at 7 p.m. this Thursday and Friday for Tuscaloosa Investment District Urshan Revival Services via Zoom. Weekly prayer calls are scheduled Sundays at 8:45 a.m., Tuesdays at 7 p.m., dial 712-775-7031, then enter access code 927-247-POUND. If our services have blessed you today and you wish to bless the church with a donation, you can give by means of Cash App, $ST.PETER.AME.ZION1, or Giveify. Search for St. Peter AME Zion Church, Tuscaloosa, Alabama, or you may mail your donations to St. Peter AME Zion Church, 3033 26th Street, Tuscaloosa, Alabama, 35401. So if you find yourself ready to put God first in both your heart and your wallet, we encourage you to make a gift today. By giving, it also show an obedience to God by making his work a financial priority in your life. Your support allows us to preach the gospel, make disciples, and support others in our community who need help. Either way, we want to thank you for your generous support. Every contribution helps. To our members, thank you for being an active and faithful member of our church community by giving to our church on a regular basis. You're sure that our church has a meaningful place in your heart and that financial support makes a difference. We earnestly appreciate your ongoing support. You are a valued member of our church family. However, if you're a member and have not been given faithfully, we encourage you to keep your commitment to God. God wants a cheerful giver. May God bless all of you. Let me pray before we close out. For those that may be still searching for God, for those that may have took a break from God, and for those that I'm looking for a worship place for God. Let us pray. Eternal God, thank you once again for the preacher that has brought us the message that we may have love for another, Reverend Abernathy. Lord, we thank you for how you used him in to bring your word to us. And Lord, not only that he brought the word, Father, we heard it. But then, Father, we ask right now that you would help us to be doers of the word that was brought forth. Father, we thank you for loving us when we couldn't even love ourselves. Your scripture tells us in your word, Lord, out of the greatest, the one is love. Father, you tell us to love one another. So, Father, we do try those things, Father, but we ask in Jesus' name for your help. Father, we ask, Lord, that you will put love, more love in us that we can disperse out among one another. Now, Father, we ask, Lord, as we move forth, that you will not only teach us how to love, Lord, but continue to give us your love. But Father, right now, we pray for those that are standing a distance away from you that are afraid to come to you, Father. Some that want to come to you, Father, but don't want to give up the things of the world. We're praying right now, Lord, that they release those things and come to you, Father, and ask the question, what must I do to be saved? Then, Father, we pray for those that have just stepped aside, Father, but still need you, Father, that are just afraid, Father, that you may not forgive them. But, Father, you said that you will forgive if we repent and confess and turn from our ways. Then, Father, we pray for those that just need a place to worship, Lord, that you would send them on this way. And not only that they would come in, Lord, and just be a bench warmer, Father, but they would be some support to the church, Father. In Jesus' name. Now, Father, as we leave the presence, Father, we leave the worship but not your presence. Father, we pray that you will continue to protect each and every one of us in Jesus' name. Father, we pray, Lord, that you will watch over the St. Peter Church family, Father, and the extended family. Protect them from the fiery darts of the devil, Father. We ask for guidance. We ask that you would order our steps, Father. We ask that you would allow us to do only the things this week that are pleasing and acceptable in your sight. Father, we ask for protection around our young children, those that are in school and out of school from this coronavirus. Protect our seniors. Protect everyone from that virus that has taken so many people out. Father, we pray for any members that are sick, Father, that even don't know that they're sick, that we lift them up to you, that they will be healed. And remember that you comfort, and especially the Boney family right now, Father, that you would comfort them in Jesus' name. Let them know that everything will be okay. And Father, we pray, Lord, for your continuous forgiveness. In Jesus' name we ask. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you again for worshiping with us today. May God bless and keep you. Here's our prayer.